Okay, we are live. Welcome to Horror on the Orient Express. This is Call of Cthulhu, of course, and this is our episode 2 of Horror on the Orient Express. Now, if you haven't seen the first episode and you're watching the archive version of this, well, go back and watch the first episode first. But if you're watching us live, then no big deal. We'll catch up a little bit on what happened in episode 1. Take a couple minutes to do that, and then we'll be off and running. So, besides, we've got a few couple minutes to kill anyway, waiting on Vince and James, hopefully. Mm-hmm. So, anyway, let's start off with this. Patrick, or yes. Actually anybody, Tom might actually be a good choice for this. Maybe take, like, if somebody wants to do, like, a 60-second description of what we're playing, you know, like Orient Express, when it's set, and what we're doing. Anybody want to do that?
Yeah, I'll do that.
All right, go ahead.
All right. So, Orient Express is basically a Call of Cthulhu campaign involving our players being sent off on a quest by their dear friend, a professor from the British Museum, to locate five pieces of an artifact called the Cedificat. Now, what they need to gather all five pieces and take them to its originating place in Istanbul and destroy it. Well, problem is, there are other people who want the artifact. And they ain't the friendliest of types of people to get involved with. Now, it's a race against time for them to get all the artifacts and make sure that they destroy him so that its power cannot be used.
Awesome. Did James reply in the email thread?
I thought he did.
Yeah, I thought he did too.
He said he was coming, I think.
Alright then. Won't worry about that then.
Yeah.
So, Patrick, what happened, briefly, what happened last episode?
Mm-hmm. So, basically, our last episode was the very first beginning episode of our characters, setting up on their journey. What happened was is that they got contacted by Professor Smith and from London to attend his lecture. Now, after the lecture, they were spending around London, and the professor contacted them again. When they came to see him, it turns out he was attacked by Turkish cultists, or at least supposed Turkish cultists. He was completely burned, and his manservant was taking care of him in secret, away from prying eyes and the police. And they contacted the investigators in order to tell them about the artifact and sent them and make sure that they are the ones that get all the five pieces and destroy them. Now, while in London, they also kind of did their own investigation about the goings on. Their investigation on the artifact made them find a man who was completely skinned in the library, with a note saying, "The skinless one will not be denied."
Ow.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
That's gotta hurt.
Yes.
It's a bad day for him.
Yes.
And my character totally didn't see that and just...
Yeah.
Stand roll.
Yes. So, they made their way across the seas into Paris, into France, aborting the Orient Express, kind of the more simpleton version of the Orient Express, and they're now riding into Paris. And that's where we left off.
All right. Oh, there's James coming in. Then, while we wait, hey, James, while we wait on Vince, let's do not as much as the first episode, but just a real quick, concise introduction of your characters, names, and a little bit about your character. Let's do that real quick while we wait for Vince. We'll start with Corey, and then go down the line.
Okay, so my character is Dr. Wilfred Price. He is a professor at the Arkham University. He basically was going on vacation to Istanbul.
Uh-oh.
Oh dear.
Yes.
Corey froze.
Oh, right. Did I?
Yeah, but I'm here, you know. Okay, you're on frozen. Go on.
Okay, so just I'll repeat that. Dr. Wilfred Price, he is a professor at the Arkham University, a chemistry professor, and also a natural history professor too. He is going back to Istanbul when on vacation. And that's basically it.
All right. James, you're next.
My character's name is Walter Wheel. He is a small-time con artist. He is friends with Dennis Malone and Margot. And he's been on a couple of ventures with some of the characters here and had some interesting interactions with other characters. Let's just say that.
Oh, don't worry. You'll get your comeuppance.
All right, Kim's next.
I'm playing Rose Noble. That's Rose, not Donna. Rose. It's Rose. Remember that. I'm a lounge singer in the speakeasy where we all meet, and I'm here overseas with my uncle, who dragged me along with him on a book sale. I'm happily getting away from him and joining the rest of my friends. I'll go wherever you guys go, seriously. Anything that gets me away from my freaking uncle.
Save me!
Okay, Lily.
I'm Roscoe Otis, and I had the misfortune of running into these people.
Yes, I believe your first interaction was that when you were met with the end of Isaac's gun.
I was just trying to help the lady with her bags down.
And then Patrick is, of course, our keeper. I'm assisting him. Tom, you're next.
My character's name is... is Alexei Ivanovich Pleshchikov. He's a concert pianist from Russia. He escaped just before the Bolshevik Revolution. And he's now living in the United States, actually in Arkham. He recently had a falling out with his manager, and he decided to go on sabbatical to Europe to sort of pursue his esoteric interest in the occult. And it was at the London...
lecture.
I'm going to need you to say your character's name five times really fast.
Alexei Ivanovich Pleshchikov. Very good. An interesting thing that I discovered.
Yes.
Is the middle names for Russians.
Mm-hmm.
His middle name is Ivanovich. What that means is that his father's name was Ivan. Or daughter of.
Yeah. Yeah, Baltic names are often like that a little bit.
So I guess my last name would be Harovich.
also missing two of our student investigators, Vincent, who's playing Dennis Malone, a tough guy who likes to punch people in the throat, and joining them is Isaac O'Connor's gun savvy mercenary. And Margot.
Somebody want to talk about Leah's character real quick? She's sick.
Oh, yes. Yes. Margot. She is a tattooed lady who knows how to run a seance and often uses the cult to trick people. Sound about right?
Sounds about right.
Yeah.
She's your friend, boy, Alter.
Well, we'll go ahead and get started, and Vince can just jump in whenever he gets here. Maybe we'll have a chance to redshirt him before he gets here. We'll see.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Very good, very good. All right, so let's get underway, shall we?
Let's.
All right. So, I'm gonna back up a little bit. And so basically, when we last left off, you guys, your train was making its way to Paris. So now I'm gonna kind of start you off. If you have an hour before Paris, And you're on the Orient Express. Is there anything else you'd like to do on the Orient Express before it docks at the station?
I just want to have a look around.
Mm-hmm.
I want to explore the cars.
Yeah, I want to explore the cars too.
Very good.
My character wants to get lunch.
Huh?
I see my character wants to get lunch.
Yeah, what time of day is it, by the way?
Mm-hmm. You'd be probably arriving around 10-ish, and probably in Paris. So, give or take, it's about 9, 9.30.
At night or in the day?
Day.
A very early lunch sounds like an excellent idea.
Or late breakfast.
Brunch. This is easy. Brunch. Mm-hmm.
Let us go, Alexei. We will figure out the finalities of it later.
Yeah.
Food is food.
You'll figure out what to call the meal later.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah. If you guys remember, I sent you all the Traveler's Almanac, and on it is actually a menu of what they serve on the Orient Express.
Very cool.
Yeah, that's a 54-page manual.
I know.
Indeed.
It's on
the sixth page is the menu. It's like right in front.
It's about as far as I got.
Oh, you guys act like you got jobs or something.
Nah.
Yeah, come on, guys.
What's about this book reading you talking about?
All this learning.
Roscoe can't read. He knows what money faces look like. That's about it. And how to sign his name.
Yeah. Hmm. All right. So, let's see here. So, you guys kind of sat down, and you guys kind of have a meal. They have a very nice selection. And, yeah, so you guys choose what you want, and you eat. And after you eat, the train slowly arrives to the station. And, people are exiting off. And then you guys exit off as well. You guys get your luggage, and you are now in Grand Central Paris.
Has Isaac given us a place where we're supposed to stay?
No, that's all on you. However, Isaac has taken the liberty of contacting his contacts in here in Paris, and he's managed to kind of get himself a safe house if you guys want something out of the way.
Sounds like a good idea.
Sure, why not?
Okay.
Now just keep in mind, this is a safe house. This is high standards.
Yes. You all have the option to go to like a more luxury hotel.
I have no problem with a safe house because, well, I'm used to rundown digs.
Yeah, what I would like to do is before we go to the safe house or the hotel, whatever you choose, I would like to pick up a French translation book.
Ah, a French dictionary. They probably would sell those around the station, so that's probably easy to pick up. So I'm hearing that everyone wants to go to Isaac's safe house. No one wants to go to a luxury hotel or any other accommodations.
Well, I think we should probably stick together.
Yeah,
I'll go wherever you guys want
to
go.
Corey, actually, there's a new Google app that you can point at foreign text, and it'll translate it into English for you. Maybe you could use that. It wasn't 1926.
Yeah. Yeah.
What?
From the future!
What is this app you speak of?
What is this internet you speak of?
What app?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's like a telegraph, right?
What's a Google?
Something like that, yeah.
Let me see here. Let's see here. You guys get a taxi, and you guys kind of load up yourselves, and you guys head off into the safe house Isaac's procured. Now, it's a very standard safe house, pretty nice, all things considered, out of the way. It's if it was a hotel, it'd probably be a decent one. It's got enough room for all of you, it's discreet, and it's completely out of the way. I assume you guys unload your luggage and all that, yes?
Yep.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. All right.
Well, I have a gun on me at all times, though, just so you know.
And this is Isaac. All right, and Isaac also, basically, Isaac managed to stop by the post office, the telegram office, and you guys have received a telegram from Burroughs, from Professor Smith in London. It reads, Professor in good... yes. Professor in good care, stop. Godspeed to you. Stop. So basically, it turns out the professor is, at least to your knowledge, is okay. We're doing better. So now, you guys are kind of settled.
Telegraph back saying LOL.
Jeez.
Okay.
So are we settled in?
Yes. I assume that you guys unload your luggage. You guys get rested up a little bit more, get your coffee in, and just kind of get freshened up, and you guys are now in Paris.
Okay.
I can't believe I'm here.
How far is the safe house from the library that from the Paris library?
Paris National.
The Paris Bibliothèque Nationale. It is probably a few miles. This is Paris. It's a very big city, and you probably need to take a taxi in order to make things quicker.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, the professor and I are definitely intending to go to the library.
Yes.
And you asked me to remind you that I had rolled a 7 on something that was in Paris last time?
Yes.
You were graciously allowing me to carry that over to Paris.
Yes, I was. Thank you for reminding me.
Of benevolence.
Yes.
It will come back to haunt us.
Soon. Anyways. All right, so a few of you want to go there. That is good. The rest of you. Yes, yay, you want to tag along or no? You guys want to do some sightseeing?
Sightseeing sounds like a plan. I probably would be taking Margot with me. I'm not sure Dennis would just want something to do out of the hotel.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right.
That sounds fantastic.
Basically, if you guys want to go sightseeing, you can go see the Eiffel Tower, Notre Dame. You can go to the Bohemian District. It's not as popular as it once was, but it still has tons of, culture.
I believe there a place, I believe, called the Louvre?
Yeah, the Louvre.
The Louvre?
The Louvre.
Don't you mean Rouge?
The some kind of museum.
The
Louvre. The Paris.
Wait, what about this Rouge? I think I heard something about this Rouge.
Yeah.
You want to wait in line.
Well, give me a second here. I will. Yeah, let me see.
This is the 30s. I don't think there was much of a line back then.
Yes. It's basically the Museum of Art I was talking about. The Musée de la Rouge. It is a very popular museum filled with many expensive statues, artifacts, and just paintings.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And Margo goes, oh, really?
Sure, let's go take a look at that, then.
Patron of the arts, that's all.
Yes. There's also the catacombs, if anyone wants to go.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Anyway. Alright, so one thing, so basically, as you guys get settled in, you guys go to the museum, and basically, the French Museum is very, very strict on its policy to getting people into its, inventory. You guys have been doing research in the British Museum, and as such, I'm going to assume that you guys weren't dumbasses and forgot to send out a letter that you could use, a permission to use the books in the French Museum. So I'll say that you guys are smart. I would say you're smart enough, and you guys sent out a letter saying that, can we use your books, please?
You mean in the library?
Yes. basically, they received your letter, your letter, from the British Museum, and now they've kind of clarified it, but now it's going to take 3 days for the bureaucracy to kick in with the British Embassy. Saying since you guys are American, the British Museum has to go to the American Embassy and so on and so forth. And that will probably take 3 to 4 days.
And how long are we here for?
You guys don't have a time limit. You guys don't know, you guys don't know who's after the artifacts, if they're any closer than you are, you don't know anything.
Okay.
But the wait is required, sadly. Naturally, as you go along, all of you kind of, when you guys kind of exit out of your safe house, dealing with the, usual comeuppance, you see Isaac out in the front, kind of talking to a man. He's got like a hat, a very wool cap on, with dark sunglasses and a beard, wearing a long dark trench coat, and they're talking to each other. You guys kind of caught the end of it. They basically shake hands, and, he walks off, and basically looks at you guys.
Who is that?
That was Leon, love. He's one of my contacts here in Paris.
Right.
Listen, says he's got us a job lined up if we need it.
What kind of job?
He said his boss needs us to do some deliveries.
Yeah. Walter made those when he was younger and don't seem to have the same spring in my step.
Said he'd be one for a time. Said he'd offer a support, a translator, even a car if we needed it.
When's our train leaving?
The Orient Express has multiple schedules, so it's not like you have a specific date you have to get this done by. It's like the minute you like finish up, there'll probably be a train of the Orient Express leaving when you are leaving.
Okay. So, here's a question for everyone.
We have time to kill.
We have as much time as we want to kill. However, does this feel like it's worth our time, considering that we have someone funding our expedition, so to speak, anyway?
Yeah, I really don't think we should go to do this, but if we have to, if the rest of the group wants to, then I'll...
Well, the other thing to remember is that you're in a race. You are in a race against time, against the
exactly
bad guys that are trying to find this thing.
But you also remember that you're waiting 3 days regardless for the.
See, that's what I was asking.
But would since my character is Turkish, would it be faster for with the Turkish embassy faster than the?
No. No, it would not be, because you had to go to the...
really long in all languages.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, I just thought I would see if that was faster than...
Yes.
Okay, so hang on a second. You said we can leave at any time, but we have to wait 3 days for what particular reason?
To get access to the Library of France.
Oh, we have to wait 3 days for the library.
It's because of the bureaucracy involving... You guys are not like scholars of France, like of the French, like university, or even employees of the library, and they will not let anybody touch these things.
Yeah, but I don't think you are.
Well, I am the niece of a bookseller. Would that
no?
No, no. Where you'd steal a book?
This library is considered one of the greatest libraries in the world. The stuff here they have goes far back as to probably the earliest days of France. You can probably learn anything about French history in this time period. And it is completely and utterly protected, and they will not just let anybody go out unsupervised without any paperwork of, notification. They need confirmation of who you are. Mm-hmm. And so that's why... After I'm going to the British Museum, you guys send out a letter of request and with some permission from British scholars confirming who you are, and now they're checking it out with the U.S. and British embassies to confirm it and allow you access.
Professor Price, I have a suggestion for us. Since we have to wait a few days, why don't we go to the University of Paris and speak to the Professor of Antiquities, see if he knows anything about the Sedevkar Simulacrum.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure that we would be able to do that.
We should be able to just walk in and find him. And
sounds like a good idea.
Yeah.
That is a good idea.
Mm-hmm. Let's go to the university then.
All right. So is everyone going to the university, or just like how are we doing this?
I'll go.
Otis, do you feel like going to a higher education, or do you feel like making some extra money?
I was leaning towards the money.
Okay. You don't want to.
You guys gonna be busy anyway.
No, of course. I think our more scholarly types in our group can go to the university, and Margot, Dennis, myself, and Roscoe can go do this job for Isaac.
It's Isaac's contact. Isaac's just kind of introducing you. All right. One moment, please. Let me take some notes out. Okay. So the Parisian university. Does anyone? Out of curiosity, does anyone have any French speaking skills?
Yes, I do.
I'm sorry. What did you say?
French. You guys are in Paris.
Yeah. No, but I did get that dictionary. So that might help.
That will probably give you 10 to 20 at most. This is.
That will get you a couple of less hours looking at the page going, what the hell does this say?
I lived in Paris for a short period of time. I speak a little French.
In the Bohemian sector? No doubt.
No, I'm a concert pianist. I lived in a nice place. I only went to the Moulin Rouge once.
And that was by accident.
Yeah,
by accident.
I believe you were involved with an Argentinian man falling from the ceiling. I don't know.
Yes, and we sang "The Hills Are Alive with the Sound of Youth." I wonder when Toulouse-Lautrec was. If this would be his period.
Let's just leave it to our own interpretation of what. You know, who was it around?
La 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 la.
All right. So, you guys go to the French Museum, and there is there's a lot of professors around, and they're all the students going around doing the classes. So, what exactly do you guys want to learn or contact? Like, who do you want to speak to exactly?
Well, I think that we go to administration and find out who the professor of antiquities is.
Mm-hmm.
Another idea that I have is if I can talk to the administration, the person that's in the library, maybe you can get some information while waiting for the big library.
Yeah, their library's probably got lots of connections.
Most likely, but we'll see. Okay, let's start with your antiquities, Professor, and we will move on. Okay. So, basically, they say that... let's roleplay the professor. So there's a secretary in the front. She sees you all, and she goes, "Bonjour."
Bonjour.
Bonjour.
May I help you?
I just smile politely.
He would
speak French. In French, I say we're looking for the professor of antiquities. Who would that be?
Oh yes, that would be Professor Lemat.
You're going to have to spell that one.
Yeah.
Lemat. Lynette.
All right. Where would we might we find him?
He is in his office. Do you have an appointment?
No, we don't, but it's kind of urgent.
For what reason?
We wish to discuss a certain artifact with him that we are coming from the United States to study.
Oh, my. That is a very important matter. I will go contact him and see if he's interested in meeting you. If you give me a moment. And she steps away from her desk and makes it off. And basically, you know, she walks off and basically she comes back and says, he'll be willing to see you if you come.
Oh. Uh-oh, who did we lose? Oh, there we go.
Okay.
All right, so we're going to come and see him.
All right, so she's going to introduce you. So basically there's his office, there's like papers, books scattering around, there's even some old like little artifacts here and there. And then basically you see him, you know, he even looks at you. He's kind of like a middle-aged man with glasses and a very nice growing beard out, very nice growing beard. And he basically says up, he says, bonjour, you are the Americans, yes?
Yes, very pleased to meet you.
Yes. Pleased to meet you, too.
Don't let my Russian accent fool you.
Indeed. All the way from America, my. May I ask what brought you here?
Well, we were sent by Professor Smith to collect information on a certain ancient artifact. We are waiting to find out information from the library. Mm-hmm. You know, the bureaucracy, we're trying to get through all of that. We were hoping you would have some information on the artifact called the Senefkar Simulacrum.
Basically, he looks very thoughtfully at you, and he nods. It's like, yes, Professor Smith, tall man, yes, a bit of a beard, scientific exploration into the unknown, the explaining, yes?
Exactly.
Yes.
I've been in contact with him, actually, for a while now. He was asking about similar facts. You said the devil is Sinavatra, yes?
Yes.
You speak everything in this show.
Yes. basically, he looks at his papers and says, well, the information I have been able to gather has been fairly limited, but I have, through many searching, I've located a reference called a manuscript called The Devil's Simulacra, written by an anonymous Sectarian monk around 1260. It was bound in Venice. In 1505, the book was considered the work of a mad cleric, and it was only known in some occult circles. But it was kept in the Church of Santa Maria Castle in Venice.
I try to say in the best French as I can. What language is this transcript written in?
Give me a percentile roll on your French.
So you're giving me 20% then?
Sure.
Nope.
He's like, what does this have to do with horses and my mother and a car?
I was gonna say.
And bestial fetishes.
No, oh my, I didn't think you felt that bad.
Yeah.
Well, perhaps I will try.
Yeah. You have like a pretty decent percentile, so I won't have you roar. He basically says it's in Latin.
Latin.
Mm-hmm.
One language I did not take in college.
It's the foundation of all languages.
No, it's not. Greek is.
I don't have Latin.
Mm. Is there anything else you wish to know?
We don't really know exactly what we're looking for. Is this a big statue, a little statue, pieces of a statue?
I believe the statues can vary. I've only been able to look at a manuscript of what the professor was asking for. I'm afraid, any further knowledge... I'm sorry?
Was there ever a drawing made, a woodcut or a drawing or something?
Not of what I was not able to locate one, sadly. I'm afraid if there was one, we do not have it or it has been lost to history. All I have been managed to locate is this so-called manuscript written by a mad cleric.
Ah. Professor Price, do you have anything else?
I would like, since we're waiting 3 days, I would like to see if maybe I could check their library at the university, if we could find something interesting that maybe we can look up more in the big library.
Okay. Professor, it's been very nice meeting you. You've been of great help to us.
Of course. Tell me, is Professor Smith all right? I haven't heard from him in a while.
He was in an accident, but he is recovering nicely.
Oh dear, is it anything serious?
Well, it was an injury. His home that he lived in had a fire, and he was burned. But he and his servant are okay.
Oh, that is wonderful to hear. Oof. Well, if you need anything else, or if you want to talk about what else the professor has asked me to try and research for him, I'll be on, by all means. Please, stop by.
If you find out anything more, would you be willing to send us a telegram, and I give him the address where we're staying?
All right. Yes, of course. I should be able to do that, no problem. I do not know if I will be able to find anything else. I have seemingly exhausted all my sources. But,
So if if we find some of the pieces of the statue, we could always send you a telegraph of our progress.
I'm afraid I am not interested in relocating the statues. I have much to do, and I'm afraid I will be on tour giving a lecture soon. So I'm afraid that will be a bit hard for me. But I do wish you well.
I want to do one last thing before we leave. I want to do a sort of a spot, hidden object, a look around his room to see if there's anything fishy.
All right, my own name.
Yeah, you know what? If I can, I'll also look around too, because I want to make sure that...
Discreetly.
All right.
Bet Rose could too.
Just wait one second. I would like to see if I would like to do a psychology roll on him to see if he is body language is see if he's like lying or something like that.
By all means.
Okay, I pass my psychology roll on him.
All right, so what you're told is basically that he's not lying. He's telling completely being honest. He appears to seem to be telling an entire truth to you. If anything, it seems he's a bit frustrated at the fact that he's not able to find out more of what the professor was asking about. But, you know, he's been, you know, trying... It appears he's been really worn out because of his search for this, because he's been really dedicated to the job.
I would try that because you never know if he got bribed or something like that. So.
Well, that's weird. Looking around his room, I rolled a 23.
Yeah.
Out of 25. 25 is what I.
Yeah.
Which there's nothing there. There's nothing there.
Well, hold on. So basically, you passed your roll, right?
Yes.
Okay, so you don't find anything like odd per se, but you do notice an article that he was seeming to read in connection to the seven Lovecraft, kind of like a separated statue, and it appears to be an article about King Louis, one of the first kings of France, and how basically when King Louis was a very good king, sadly he died from cholera, and when he died, his body was in a very terrible condition for transporting him back to Paris. So what they did was they kind of separated his limbs and kind of more or less put them in plaster and clay and a bunch of other chemicals to kind of dry out the skin and make sure that they could transport it more easily back home.
Hmm. That's interesting. Well, we don't want to keep the professor any longer, so I think we should probably leave.
Of course.
Yeah.
All right.
Will you go to the library at the university?
I'm sure you could be able to use it.
Alright.
Okay.
Alright, so you wish it au revoir?
Au revoir.
That's a good point. Go ahead,
Coyne. Oh, no, I'm not. Asking.
Sorry, what you're
saying? I was just going to say, that's a good point. Kenneth Bundy just wrote on the message board, I don't think handing out the safe house address all willy-nilly is a sound practice.
I know, but I can't.
Well, of course, this guy's probably pretty trustworthy. Unless secretly he's a cult member. There's always that.
Yeah.
Yes.
But he's so nice.
Yeah, he's so nice.
They're
always nice till they offer you the punch and cookies.
Yeah.
Could you sign your name here in blood, please?
They're always nice until they're telling you to put the lotion on your skin, right?
Yeah. All right, so what goes on, basically, as we carry on forward, is you guys have the access to the library. Is there anything you wish to see, look up?
Well, I would like to look up if they have any information on the French family that had the first parts of the statue.
Oh, yes. One moment. Did they give me a library roll?
Yeah, I passed.
Uh-huh. No, they do not. That is what you're asking for is something very, very old-fashioned, and that's only in the Museum of Nationale.
Yeah, I thought I would try, so.
Mm-hmm.
What about general history of the time period?
So if you'd
this
like
was
that...
in 1260, why don't we look up that time period and see what else happened?
Their records don't seem to go that far. They probably only go up to more recently is Napoleon. The Napoleonic seems to be as far as the records go. Mm-hmm. Anything, if you want old school records, you really need to go to the National Bibliothèque.
Yeah, okay.
Mm. Well, you want to go to the catacombs and look at the bones of the dead?
I prefer not to. I'll actually take a few hours and I'll check all the information on, like, just do random researching on the subject.
All right. So basically, if we're good here, do you mind if I switch over to the other guys then?
Go ahead.
Yeah.
All right. So back to our other intrepid band of heroes. So apparently Isaac's driving you guys, and you basically kind of drive through kind of the club district, and you guys pull over, and yes. And apparently there's a club called, it's a cabaret club called Casablanca.
Okay.
It's an entire club. It seems to be a very nice estate. People are exiting in and out. And he basically kind of, says, kind of motions you to come in with him.
So, I guess we go in.
Yes.
After you, Isaac.
What, are you scared? Calm down?
Cautious is probably a better word.
Guns before beauty.
And guns before brains.
That's why I'm always packing. He takes a smoke and lights it up. All right, then. Let's be off. So you guys walk in, and this is, it's a very interesting estate. There are very nice entertainers, women dressed in and basically in very scantily clad, serving girl costumes.
I feel like it would be a sort of like Night of the Roxbury, but in the 30s.
20.
What's up? Potty overload, man.
Damn it. God damn it, James. Now I'm in the mood to watch that movie again.
Yes. There's a lounge singer singing their song. You know, a few of the entertaining girls walk by. You know, they look, give you a seductive look, and you know, one of them says, "Come see me later."
Yeah, we'll carry on.
So Isaac kind of walks you through a bit, but before you guys could like get in for the club, a guy kind of approaches you. He's wearing kind of like a white dress coat with a black bow tie and dress pants.
Colonel Sanders, how are you?
With a very serious face, black hair slicked back. He says,
"Young Colonel Sanders."
And surprisingly, he speaks in an American accent.
It is the Colonel.
He goes up to Isaac and they shake hands and says, "Kid, how are you?" "Fine, Rick." "Ian?" He's like, "Yep. In the back." Alright, basically, they nod off and get going, walking back. And he basically kind of leads into the back room, and it's kind of like the secret office. And there's some of the music's muffled up. And you guys kind of keep walking through hallways. And eventually you kind of reach what appears to be a storage room with lots and lots of crates. And it appears to be a lot of guys loading them up and kind of opening a few of them and just kind of looking at the contents.
Okay. We'll wait on the queue with Isaac and whoever the contact is.
Yeah. So once you guys... he leads you back into the proper office and you guys are met with basically kind of a large desk, and overlooking it is a guy, and he kind of looks up at you. And now, one thing you have to notice is that he has a scar going across his left eye, and it's completely white. And he's got his hair kind of ruffled up, and he's got a kind of a shoulder holster, old and open, with a spotted neck, actually.
Okie dokie. See here.
All right. So he appears to be carrying a very unique kind of handgun. The metal is a lot darker than normal pistol weapons, and the grip seems to be engraved, and it just looks very much more elegant than a standard weapon. And in the corner is the guy you saw, Leon, who's wearing his hat and dark sunglasses, and he's sitting in a chair, smoking. As all Frenchmen do. Basically goes, "Philippe, I brought him." He's like, "So these are your so-called friends."
Such a easy term thrown around nowadays.
No.
Whatever you say. He kind of walks up to you guys, and he kind of like, gets in kind of very close and kind of is like sizing you up a bit. Like all of you at one by one.
Roscoe kind of straightens up and eyes the guy back.
Yeah. Isaac tells me... Sorry?
I was just going to say, they do have spectacles if you need to look this close, sir.
Sorry, haven't seen an American around since my days in the French Legion. So, Isaac tells me you lot are familiar with my line of work, yes?
Well, Isaac never really spelled out what your work was.
He basically kind of smiles. He's like, what else? Arms dealing.
I don't know. Of course it would be with Isaac. Sure. How can we be of assistance?
He basically kind of walks you in and basically says, currently, we are running a big operation. No doubt you've met Mr. Rick Blaine out in front.
Mm-hmm.
You're trying to smuggle in some firearms into Spain. What it is, there's some money to be made in their own little civil war coming up.
Fair enough.
Now, we got there's guys like Khrushchev who will most likely make more money than we ever make. But I've recently made some few contacts. Now, I have here some documents. I need them delivered.
All right. Where would you need them delivered to?
Since you are Americans, like all good American tourists, go around to the nice, you know, to the special parts of France, yes? And you'll probably meet someone with a similar interest. You get my meaning?
Mm-hmm.
Deliver these papers for me. I will help you offer you transportation, a translator, whatever you need.
Sounds very interesting. I was also curious about...
Tea?
Yeah, well, Walter could always use a cup of tea. But I'm also curious... Who are we delivering these papers for, or to, rather?
Hey, to be rude, but this sounds awfully too easy.
Mm-hmm.
This isn't illegal, is it?
You wouldn't be asking me to commit a crime now, would you?
Exactly.
He kind of smiles like, you ain't scared now, are you?
Scared? No. I don't need your details. Really, I just want to know who I'm taking them to and if there's any trouble that I need to look out for.
These are independent arms dealers. We are looking at a negotiation to combine our shipments into one large shipment to increase our revenue and profit.
Yeah, like I said, your business is your business. I just need to know if anybody's going to shoot me.
Mm-hmm.
The less I know about your business, the better. Well, I mean, these just some papers that need to be taken to somebody as far as I'm concerned.
Yeah.
I would have Dennis and Margot do it.
basically, the only reason I ask is because I do not need to be associated with this.
Fair enough. Like I said, it's just a letter being delivered to somebody. I just need to know if there's somebody that's got an itchy trigger finger.
And what better way to deliver packages under the guise of some tourists?
Oh, of course. But as my court has mentioned, good sir.
Cohort.
It's always better to know who you drop these things off for, especially when you're going to meet them in person.
Sorry, I missed that.
Damn you, sir.
Oh, that was perfect.
You killed all that dramatic tension.
What did you say? Where's my goddamn tea?
Yep.
Siri,
not now, Siri.
Damn technology. Now,
the keeper too.
Do not worry. I know him personally. I just need his papers delivered. And we'll be all good, yes?
It's for a good cause.
Mm-hmm.
Any signal we need to know?
I'm just curious if we're delivering this for the Reich or anything like that. But
no, I don't care who we're delivering it for. The less I know, the better.
Yeah. Are we dropping this off, or do we get to meet the person? That's all I'm really concerned with.
You'll meet him.
Lovely. All right. Give us whatever package needs delivering, sir.
All right. So basically,
we'll put our demands in the mail.
All right. So he takes out a cigar and lights it up, and basically go nods to Leon, who quietly kind of, you know, goes out and pulls out kind of like an envelope, a very thick envelope wrapped around, and hands it to you quietly.
I pass it over to Mr. Malone.
Very well. It's like,
I'm pretty sure he mumbles something about you fucks, but that's fine. All right. So where are we meeting this gentleman?
Well, the catacombs.
All right then. I guess we will be going on a little sightseeing trip, folks.
Yeah. Enjoy yourselves, my friends. It is Paris.
What is Paris without the sights, eh?
Exactly.
There were catacombs I wanted to visit, just not those catacombs.
Enjoy the girls while you're here, then, my friend. Basically,
nothing happened. Find this letter.
Yes. So you guys kind of exit out. So you guys kind of enter in the back of the club. Isaac more or less, you know, goes out to see his friend Rick Lane at the bar for a quick moment. But you're welcome to enjoy some of the bar's offers if you'd like before you head out, or you can go straight to do your job.
Now let's get this over with.
All right.
We'll get
business before pleasure, right?
Yeah.
Let's get it over with so we can deal with our problems, and we'll get all...
Like I said, business before pleasure, right?
We'll get Margot's little hand pistol hidden in her muff. We'll get Dennis Ballone's little brass knuckles ready to go.
Mm-hmm. So basically, Isaac says goodbye to Rick Lane, and he goes, "Here's looking at you, kid."
Awesome.
And
the
basically,
Americans just kind of look at him. That's what we do.
Yeah. And basically, you guys are going off the catacombs.
Yay.
So now, let's go to the catacombs. Say that line, Kim. Anyways.
Let's go to the catacombs.
So the way the deal has been arranged, basically, as you can gather, is that you guys will be sneaking in and under the guise of tourists. And then once you're deep enough in the catacombs, you guys have been given a strict, like, kind of map on, like, where to diverge and meet the contact.
Mm-hmm.
Now, here's the thing about catacombs. The catacombs are filled with the dead of France. So there are, like, bones, skulls making up the walls here. And these bones are old, very old. And very, very fragile. So you guys end up in this kind of room, and you guys are waiting for your contact.
All right.
Wait, who all is going into the catacombs now?
Well, right now it's Otis.
Shady bunch.
It's Otis, Walter, Isaac, Margo, and Dennis.
Yeah.
And weren't the rest of us talking about going down there too?
Well, I know the professor didn't want to go. I think
Alexi
said he wanted to try it out, but I'm not sure what the outcome was from that.
We might bump into each other while we're there, since I'm going independently, probably.
Like I said, I would rather not go to the catacombs. I would rather, you know, listen in on some lectures and stuff like that, but my character doesn't really want to go down there. He's sort of afraid of the dead.
I'll go.
They've been down there a long time and they've never come up.
All right.
Yeah.
All Roscoe had to see on the situation is you see some strange things in the bayou.
Yeah. Okay, so as you guys wait around, you guys hear, like, getting a few of the skeletons fall. Like, the bones kind of, like, gathered around. You hear them kind of rustle and kind of hit the floor.
Damn it, it is a rave. Is there a green glow?
No.
The system.
All right.
Well, Roscoe puts his hand on the butt of his gun and is just kind of ready.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I guess we will. We're not going to go check it out because, you know, that's just. But,
I mean, you can go look if you want to.
Well, hang on a second. We're in the meeting spot, correct?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Do we know who the contact is?
More or less. He's some kind of arms dealer for the Spanish rebels.
Did we ever give him, like, any kind of, like, signal?
To call out? Anything? Were we to know who it is, or does Isaac know?
Isaac would probably have dealt with him, or probably known him.
As long as somebody knows who he is. When they see
Isaac.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Would you know who this gentleman is if you saw him?
The Spaniard? Yeah, I know him.
All right. Do you think you and Dennis could take a look and see what the noise was?
By all means.
Fair enough.
We'll be right back, you fucks.
Punch it in the throat.
Come on, Dennis. Let's go partner up as we always do.
I don't think I can do it justice, but I'm going to stay here with the fellas.
This is why we do not bring kids along anymore. Basically, so Isaac kind of taps, you know, Dennis on the shoulder, and they kind of walk off together to the place. And kind
Dennis
of...
Dennis looks at him where he hit him and just looks at shakes his head and carries on.
Straight up bugs come out of his mouth.
Yeah. Hey, Isaac saved Dennis's balls once, and that's literally not... That's not a actual, like, metaphor for anything.
True.
So, they're kind of bros at this point. Anyways.
We'll let Vincent decide that.
Well, I'm the gamekeeper, so now my word is technically law, so yes.
But you're not vindictive at all, no.
No, really not.
Okay, so basically, as they walk down... They keep walking down, and as they get closer, they see kind of a humanoid figure.
Isaac, did you bring a light?
What the hell have we been using all this time?
I have no fucking clue. Shine your light towards whoever this fuck is.
Alright. Fine. Basically, so using kind of like both the his lighter, and he kind of the tunnel kind of illuminates a little bit. And both Dennis and Isaac kind of walk up forward a little bit, and they see the humanoid figure. Now, what they see is it looks to be like human, but it looks rotting. It's got its skin is completely falling off. Some of its bones are showing, and it's wearing complete rags. And it's like it's almost got like clawed hands, and it's kind of like gathering up bones. And as it turns around, it looks at Isaac and Dennis. And it's got kind of like a muzzle with sharp teeth going out.
Oh,
and eyes. Awesome. But here's the kicker. It sees them, but it just goes on its way with its bones. It doesn't care for them. And it kind of drops into a pile.
Dennis turns to Isaac and goes, "Does that look like your contact?"
Not if he... I don't think he's... No. No.
Then I think you should plug that fucker with a bunch of bullets.
I mean, go hit that bloody fucking thing if you want to kill it.
I see how it is. But if he ain't the contact and he ain't bothering us, let him play with his bones.
Dude, it's fine by me. Come on, let's go and do this job. Get the hell out of here.
Sounds like a plan.
Alright, so you guys go back, and basically your contact does appear. He's a man wearing a trench coat, and he's got his hat kind of over his head. He's like, "Are you the contact?"
No, we just decided, we got lost from the sightseeing tour. We just decided to sit here and wait, twiddling our thumbs, just to see what would happen. But I seem to have this envelope that's very thick and very heavy.
I mean, it looks like somebody dropped it and figured somebody come back looking for it.
Mm-hmm. You look like the type of person might have dropped this.
Yes. Yes, I am.
Well, then we didn't done our good Samaritan deed for the day, now, haven't we?
Yes. He basically takes the envelope and kind of opens it up. It's like, yes. And looks very happy. It's like, "You've done a good deed, my friends."
Fair enough.
Just passing tourists.
Please have a very good day, sir.
Thank you. And basically, you guys do your business, and you guys walk off. And, yeah.
Get the hell out of here now.
Yes.
Things rolling down here.
So you did your job. So do you want me to speed things up a little bit then?
Well, I figure that Isaac and Dennis made their way back without incident.
Yep.
Nothing decided to come and say hello.
Nope.
And if they tell us what they saw, or at least that they thought they saw, I'm all for getting out of there, because Roscoe's probably gotten pretty antsy standing around all these dead people.
So you guys all make it back okay. Besides that weird little mishap. So can I speed things up then?
Yeah, go ahead.
Alright. So you kind of do your job, and basically, Philippe is very happy. Yes, and Rick, and Mr. Rick Lane is as well. You basically help deploy weapons to the Spanish rebels against the fascist party.
See, I wish you had told me that. I wouldn't have done it.
I don't know what you're talking about. I just found a letter on the way to the catacombs.
So he provides you with a transport vehicle, untraceable. And Leon was more than willing to kind of translate for you all when you need to, and kind of be your guide.
Excellent. More human shields. I mean, excellent. More people that can help us out.
Yeah. That's great. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, Leon.
Because my favorite cat.
Yeah, Leon doesn't talk much, but he pretty much, you know, takes your orders and can, you know, translate what you say.
I hope he talks a lot. He's got to translate.
Yes. He'll talk when you tell him to talk. He won't talk otherwise.
Speak. Good, Leon.
All right. So, moving on, so you guys all kind of regroup, and is there anything else you want to do before I skip past, like, the 3 days? Like, is there anything, otherwise I would just assume you go around Paris and stuff.
Yeah.
Go shopping. Credit card.
The seat.
Yes.
Or whatever.
The battery home, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. Yes. So, okay. Yeah, so well, sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, well, while I was at the university, I would ask, like, I would go and talk to, like, the chemistry professors and just, you know, just talk to and also do the lectures and stuff like that. So I would like to try and see if I can get some, like, ingredients for my chemistry set, like acids and bases and stuff like that.
Well, you probably would. Though your French is crap, so, you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if you what I the would, hell you understand from the lecture.
I would hire a translator.
Hmm. Those are pricey. All right. Moving on. So basically, here's what goes on. So for the next 3 days, you spend your time either at the, you know, the Club Casablanca, exploring the Notre Dame, the Eiffel Tower, you know, enjoying croissants and going to the local cafes in Bohemian districts. Kim and Margot, you do your shopping, you get all the latest Parisian fashions and, you know, all the lovely things that France has to offer.
Look, Margot, a new muff.
Yes.
One.
Yes. I'm pretty sure you see Sigmund Freud running around here somewhere.
Who's that loser? Yes, I'm Union.
All right. And yeah, so you guys enjoy Paris. It's very nice. Anyway, so 3 days pass, they basically get your letter of confirmation, and you are welcome to peruse the library with extreme supervision. Now, however, I have to remind you that using the library, you need you need to know French and a good library skill.
I have a 50, so I hope that's good enough.
The French, you also need French, because all this stuff is in French.
Okay. Well, like I said, I have a translator to sort of help me out.
You're translating documents that are older as they come to France's beginning history. A little pamphlet dictionary is not going to help you translate ancient French.
No. Actually, like a translator that that I talk to you to translate and stuff like that.
Hmm. But translator is not a researcher. He does not know how to operate a librarian.
Okay.
Well, I wonder if I could make a persuade roll to maybe persuade one of the librarians to come and help me. Since I have no clue what this French reads.
Kim, if you want, you could talk to one of the librarians and see if you can hire one. They are willing to, if you would like. They have a few librarians available. And you can talk to one of them and see if you'll be willing to work for you and do kind of the research.
Okay. I will do that.
All right. So they basically give you a guy called Remy. He's a college student, and he's willing to work for you, but you have to pay him. You guys got to kind of have to negotiate a fee for his work. You want me to do some research, yes? Well, I need to get paid. College loans will not pay itself.
And how much, roughly,
persuade.
Is his fee?
Persuade.
And I am going to persuade him and say...
Because I don't have very good fast talk, but I've got a good persuade.
Yeah, I'm not going to persuade. Yeah, what I'll try to say is we would like to... I would like to ask you to try to help us out here. We kind of really need you. We kind of really need the help here because we're trying to race against time.
He basically says, I don't give a shit.
Well, I made my persuade roll. I got a 58, and my persuade is 75.
He says, so basically, he's like, look. I am willing to work as long as you pay me. Maybe we can negotiate a fee, huh? Yes?
Well, isn't that why I'm trying to persuade him?
That's just, he won't work unless you pay him. He's not gonna do this for charity.
Yeah.
Listen, my friend, how much do you want?
Let's say 70 francs per day.
70 francs per day?
Yeah.
Are you sure you can't do with 70?
How good is your French?
Better than yours.
Yes, I don't think so. 70 francs. Good God, how much is that? That's like a fortune.
Yeah. Especially for the time.
Yeah. How much?
Yeah. Well, you guys, I'm going to use the bathroom, so you guys, you know, argue while I, you know. Okay?
Yep. Let's mute his mic just in case we hear anything.
Now, I'm enjoying the brothels right now.
Yeah.
The only thing I can say for negotiating, guys, is literally the only thing that I see would work would be find out what he can find out first. You never pay first. That came gone. How long ago?
I think I will do is if he finds something good, I will try and we'll pay him if he finds out anything useful to our investigation. If he doesn't, then we'll try and get him at a lower.
He doesn't find anything. You don't pay him.
Yeah, we don't pay him.
Tell him that's
worst comes to worst. If he doesn't like that, then I say we just move on to the next location.
Sounds good to me.
Yeah.
Okay. So, what happened?
I think Alexi should take point on this.
I don't think that, I'm not so sure that we're going to, I don't know. That's so much money. And we might not find out anything.
It's not, you hired me to look. If I find something, you can hire me for one day and not hire me for any other day.
All right, I'll tell you what, I'm going to pay you some money, but the first thing I would like you to find out is everything you can on a Comte Fenelik.
Okay, let's discuss your price. How much will you pay me?
Well, I'll pay you 10 francs to find some information on this person, at least where we can look for the information.
Ten francs. Try again.
Okay. I would like to see if you can find any information on that family that last known had the statue. We'll pay,
that's the company Fenelik.
Yeah.
Oh, is that okay, Fenelik? Yeah.
Yeah. He basically says, if you do not pay me, I will not look.
What if we give you 10 francs, and if you find anything interesting, I will pay the rest.
About 10 francs an hour.
10 francs an hour? Make it...
Well, because then he'll take forever.
Well, we'll watch him. We'll be right behind him every step of the way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
About 20 up front, and the rest when you find what we need.
All right. Can you guys give me a psychology roll?
Psychology? Yeah, I'll try to do that. I'm pretty good at my psychology. Yeah. And yeah, I got a 0.02.
Yes. All right. So basically, looking at him, you realize that if you want him to do a good job, you gotta really pay him at least 50 francs. 20, and he'll probably slack off.
Okay.
All right, 50 francs up front.
Ooh, very well. Let's get to work, shall we? All right, so basically, let's move on. Okay, so basically, he looks around, so for like the next while or so, he goes looking through the library, looking through the directories, speaking to librarians, and just constantly looking for your information that you require. Excuse me, one. Let me get my notes out. Da, 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 da. Where are you notes? Ah, very well. So, basically, by using... Okay, so basically, he uncovers a few documents, and it's kind of over the next couple days, he keeps getting you more a few documents. Each day, little by little, you guys slowly get more documents. Okay? So... The first thing he found is apparently a diary from Mademoiselle de Brigny from June 1789. It reads the following. The Comatin was like a sun amongst us, shedding his light and making us rejoice in his pleasures. His feasts are said to be the most lavish and lavishest year in our scene in our city. It was then that it became apparent that much evil was afoot. And the queen became angered. The king's men did raid the house, and much was destroyed. And the comet there was arrested.
Interesting.
So apparently, apparently comet was some kind of German count, and apparently there was a scandal involved with the queen of France. And he was apparently executed without a trial.
Wow.
That's at least so far, like the data he's uncovering. Like, and he had to go like through some really old archives to do this. So, you know, yeah. So, it's a good thing you hired him.
A comte is owns land. What land did he own? Where was his house? Do we know this?
He can probably look that up along with other information.
Okay, that's the information I want to find out.
All right.
Yeah.
It is.
All right. Okay, so basically you found another report from the captain that raided the house. When we arrived, the feast was still in progress. Men and women were rutting like rabid dogs. We chased them out, arresting the ones who were not able to vouch for themselves. I sent 6 men to capture the Comete. While I entered the chambers beneath, I could not bring myself to describe what I saw there, save what we ventured was cesspool, and it was hell. God help us all. Many devices of torture lay in many small chambers. One of my men found a strange Nuremberg virgin that was locked. Fearing to find a fresh occupant, he smashed it open, but found it to be empty. It was a dark day, when noble vermin such as Pendleton did not descend upon poesy, and if God does not punish him for his sins, when King surely will. It was with our heart that I give the order to burn the house and those who remain below. The Comte did howl and scream as though his very soul was burning. We then took him to the palace. That would be his new home, where he may rot.
So did you say they burned the house?
Apparently, yes, they did. But they ransacked it more. It would be probably a more accurate term. He's translating all of this for you in English, by the way.
Right.
And, you know, apparently this was more, they did, like, you know, take some things, they burned it down, they kind of took what was, you know, from it, and, you know.
Well, we know from the professor's notes that the statue was with him, and that after that it was broken into pieces, and the pieces were distributed throughout the country.
Yeah. Yes. So apparently you're getting closer. Let me see here.
I think that a piece went to Venice, and that a piece might still be here in Paris.
Yes. Oh, yeah. And, okay, so looking up, The villa, like the house, you do find like where the villa was located. So apparently, the Count Fenwick had a villa here in outside of Paris, in Poissy. It was, and that's where they burned down the house, and that's like and you have an address, and that's kind of where you found his last known residence.
One more. Did he find any information on roughly where those pieces are, or no?
You only got addresses. To find the pieces, you have to go looking more.
No, I meant like where the locations, like the locations of the pieces are.
Like all the pieces? Like, do you have a general idea given from the professor's notes?
Yeah. Okay.
Hold on, I got one more little thing to read. It's the journal of Lucien, regard June 1789. Two nights later, after the soldiers and of the king went into first come to his villa to halt his success, after they burnt his mansion, they brought the commandant before the king's deputy, who ordered me to present a deliver option. Commandant Philip was screaming and raving. It was easy to see that he was mad. As a nobleman and a madman, he could not be expected to be executed. So I suggest that a mere merciful king might place Fenwick in a charlatan. The king's deputy apparently decided upon his course and arranged Fenwick to be taken there. There, the king expressed his approval and made the decision made him permanently. The last I learned of him, he has been locked away in a cellar because he attacked other patients. So basically, you discover that that Fenwick was sent to an asylum.
And where would that asylum be? Is there a place we can go?
Yes. It is the sharp. I'm sorry. I'm hearing a lot of static and music in the background. Is someone have phone turned on by accident?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out where that's going from too.
That's not. Yeah, that's not...
James, yeah. Maybe you need to reset, James.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, the Charlatan...
Oh, it's not me for once. Awesome.
It's gone now.
Yeah, alright. So it's basically the asylum is Charlatan Asylum. It's Charlatan, obviously. And, let me see. Did it down. Looking around through it, though, more recent... You do manage to... Remy... It says that he remembered reading an article about an obituary from there. Very recently, actually. It's actually a very recent article. It reads, it's from a newspaper. It's like, it reads, it's an obituary. It reads, Dr. Enid Duplessis. We mourn the loss of our esteemed director, Dr. Enid Duplessis, as a man of highest professional standard and a true pioneer in the field of neurology. His loss by a tragic accident comes as a great blow. We hope at the hospital extend our heartfelt sympathies to his family, hoping that he may overcome their grief in time. Dr. Duplessis will be missed by the Charlatan community, Paris at large, and the glorious nation of France and civilization everywhere. Dr. Fritz Leroux, acting director.
And what was this dead person's name again?
Fenwick. Comete Fenwick.
No, the person the obit was for?
That was for Dr. Ethan Duplace. This is he was worked at the asylum.
Okay.
And whereabouts is this asylum located?
In Charlatan.
Okay.
Is there anything you'd like to know? Anything else about the information or anything specific that you want Remy to look up more?
Well, what was the gem that I got back in London?
What gem?
Remember you said that, yeah.
Yeah, right.
No, okay. Seven?
Yeah, I'm sorry. So, looking in the inventory, you realize that basically that you find an inventory of what was ransacked during the kind of raid on the manor.
Okay.
It reads, wine, snuff boxes, silk clothing, paintings, a few treasury, and statuary. Incomplete.
Really?
Yes.
There you go.
And does it tell us where this is being, where this ended up?
No. It says statuary incomplete, and Ruby tries to look up more records, but it seems those were destroyed in the French Revolution.
Hmm.
Okay.
What about the Devil's Simulacrum? Is that here in this building?
No, that's in Venice.
Okay.
Well, is there any more background information we can find out about it before we end up in Venice?
Only what, like, Remy has, you know, like, only what the professor's told you. Basically, the professor and Remy both looked at the same source for information, and you could probably only find out the same thing he found.
Okay.
Anything else?
Okay. No, I think that's...
I can't think of anything.
That's all that I have, so...
Very good.
And... how much do we owe Remy?
Probably a week's worth of pay.
Okay.
Well, we'll talk about and we'll just leave.
If I would like to do that, but I also know that he could. I don't want to.
Well, you guys have been paying him each day. Otherwise, he would never have done, like, oh, I'll pay you at the end of the week. No. Day by day, up front.
Okay.
And he's been helpful, so
pay him. Yeah. Well, he's translated these notes for you. He's looked very in-depth about them. He's been working entirely a week doing all this stuff and making sure they're accurate translations for the pay you've given him.
Yeah.
Oh, so an entire week has passed now?
Yeah. But it's been very productive. You managed to find a lot of information, and that's good.
Yes, we have. So, I don't mind paying him.
Yeah. Okay, so basically, it seems you have two locations. You have the asylum, and you have the remnants of Fenwick's villa.
Sounds good.
Okay.
I don't want to go to the asylum. I would rather go to the house. Or what's
yeah.
Left.
So would I.
Honestly, in my opinion, I would actually rather go to the asylum, actually.
We thought you would.
Yeah.
Have you guys got met together with us?
You're afraid of dead people, and I'm afraid of crazy people.
So you're afraid of the dead, and you're afraid of the living. Makes sense.
Yeah.
So we have a split decision. Are you guys going to split up?
Are groups back together?
Yes. You have discovered two possible leads.
Then,
asylum and an old wrecked villa.
Well, Walter has experience going to asylums, so happy to try that out again.
Yeah, like... It's not my first choice, but like I said, I'd rather go to the asylum.
Come on, Dr. Pris. I mean Price.
Who else going to the villa? I'll go with them to the asylum.
I don't like to split up, but this might...
Well, we kind of need to move things along, too. We've been here a while.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
We should
stay together, but at the same time, we've been here a week. We've already wasted a week.
Yeah, and time is not our friend in this case.
But our week was really productive, though.
That's still not the point. We still wasted a week, so we need to split the party again.
Yeah, so let's do this.
Yep.
All right, so...
Probably, I would think Dennis would enjoy going to the asylum and roughing people up.
I don't think Dennis really liked going to the asylum in the past anyway, so I know Marco had no problem. So let's have Isaac, Walter, Dr. Price, and Margo go. to the asylum, and I guess everyone else can go to wherever the other spot is.
All right. Yeah.
And we'll do that. Let's see. Which do you want to do first, Patrick?
Let's do this. Let us do the asylum first.
All right, then.
So basically, Charlton Asylum is kind of the like the main asylum of Paris almost. It's mm-hmm. it's probably one of the oldest. It's been here since God knows how long, and it's gotten renovated since the days of like primitive madhouses. And anyone who knows like old like kind of like well more like insane asylums from back in the Middle Ages. They were like prisons and torture houses. They would beat their patients. They would torture them for fun, and it was downright disgusting. And this place has been around since like the foundation of those times. Although it has been renovated, it still kind of appears to have that same visage as it once did.
Yeah.
So basically, you kind of ride in, and again, so the asylum is open. So how do you guys want to proceed?
Well, Walter's not really sure who he's supposed to speak to, because he hasn't...
You would probably want to speak to the desk first.
Yeah.
Or even ask the director. Yeah.
If we're going to go to the desk, we got to know who we're asking for. So I'll let Dr. Price take lead point on this, because he was at the... he was the one that got the information, so... Dr. Price, if you want to go up and introduce yourself.
I walk up to the desk and I ask for the person who's in I would ask how you're doing, and I would just ask who is in charge. We would like to talk to
very good. One sec. Okay, so basically, she basically says that would be Dr. Lyrix. He is currently the head director after Mr. Diplett's recent departure.
We would like to talk to him, please.
And you are?
I am a doctor, Wilfred Price.
Do you have an appointment?
No, we don't, but I would like to make an appointment.
Give me a persuade or cred roll.
Okay. I would do my persuade. It's a little bit better, so.
All right.
Apparently, Walter sat in something. His credit rating didn't pass, but his persuade passed with flying colors.
Yeah, all right. my persuade works.
All right. So basically, if you kind of persuade her, saying that you're important, and you know, since you're a foreigner, she just kind of lets you into Dr. Lennox's office, and you know,
stupid Americans.
So basically, Dr. Lennox is a very conservatively dressed man. He's very, like, looks uptight, little chubby, and he's very, looks like nothing's out of place. He looks very strict and stern. And he's like, yes, may I help you?
Yes. I am Dr. Wilfred Price, and we would like to know about some information that happened to at your asylum, I would say long ago.
How long?
In the 1700s.
Why would you want to know that?
We basically have a lead in our investigation. And a research paper saying that we need to see we need to find some artifacts. And apparently the person that was in your asylum was holding part of the artifacts.
Well, we do not contain any things like that. If any artifacts were here, they were most likely transported a long time ago to the museums and libraries and such.
But he had the information on the artifacts we need?
He's been... If it's since the 1800s, he'd be dead already.
I understand that. But do you have any... do you have any records of whatever the person's name?
What is that person's name, Patrick, by the way?
Cometa Fenlick.
Fenlick. Thank you.
Yeah. Fenlick. Do you have any records of Fenrick?
He basically kind of shakes Fenlick. He's like, my duty here is not to remember the historical records of this hospital, only to make sure that it runs effectively and efficiently.
Of course.
One thing I want to also bring up is, looking around the room, you see a lot of empty crates. And could you guys give me a spot hidden roll?
Yep.
Twenty-seven, sweet.
All right.
I don't see anything.
Okay, so James.
Stuff in your eye.
James, so basically, you notice in the crates. You see what in the crates? It appears to be like all the stuff of the doctor who passed away recently. What you notice specifically is a bound letter journal, and on it is like on a clipboard, kind of like high over it, kind of says E. Delplace, in that event, 1923.
Does this, not to sound like I haven't been paying attention, but does this seem important?
Yes. Yes, it is.
Okay. And this, how far away is this container, so to speak?
It's on the side. There's a lot of containers because the doctor recently passed away, so they're trying to clear out his medical files and such.
Is this in this other doctor's office right now? Like, I'm just trying to get the lay of the land.
You're in the same office.
It's the same office of the doctor that just
died. He was the former director. The doctor who died was the former director of the asylum, and they're kind of clearing out the office, so it's kind of like, you know, they're packaging this stuff up.
Okay. Walter will try to discreetly walk over to the where the stuff is.
All right.
And try and give a little knowing nod to Margot.
Okay.
It'd sort of be a bit of a distraction.
All right. So, yeah, so, okay, so Margot kind of, you know, says, you know, well, look over here. and a guy...
Do you find it so interesting?
Yes. And then basically, he's like, don't touch that. And then basically, while he's, like, you know, yelling, you know, you swipe the journal and kind of shove it into your pocket, and then...
Well, how big is the journal? Is this something that would go under a waistcoat, or is this something...
Yeah, waistcoat.
Okay, so, yeah.
It seems more like a personal kind of log entry, kind of like, you know, notes taking, you know, for note taking.
Was there anything else in the box that, worthwhile taking?
No, it seems like, this seems to be more, again, mostly old, you know, old documents. Old documents of, like, medical tests and, like, kind of statuses of the asylum. This seems to be a very recent personal journal, so that's why it's of interest.
Mm-hmm. Is there any fancy pens?
I guess on his desk.
Okay. Walter will walk up to this gentleman and say, now, we know that this guy just passed away, or are we just sort of...
You know.
Yeah. I want to let you know that I am greatly sorry for your loss. I'm sure this gentleman was a very good doctor in your facility. One thing I do want to bring up is I'm very curious if you know anything about this gentleman, Mr. Fenrick. If you know anything at all, that would be great. If you do not, sir, we apologize for wasting your time.
He kind of bolsters up a moment, but then calms himself down. He's like, no, I do not.
Fair enough. One last thing, if you don't mind. What the hell is that? And Walter sort of does this lean onto the table to point behind him. And as he turns around and steals one of his pens.
All right. And he kind of turns back and he's like, what the blazes are you trying to pull here?
What is that thing? And just points to some random thing on the shelf.
That's a book.
Yes, books have titles.
He's like, get out of my office before I have you evicted.
Fair enough. Thank you for your time, sir.
Yeah, thank you for your time.
Yes. Natural Walter charm, pissing off people.
Does it very well.
Alright, so basically, exiting kind of the asylum, looking at the diner, the journal, you basically find a few entries from Dr. Delplace, and these are very recent.
Mm-hmm.
So, entry number one. A dismaying event last night. A male nurse, one of Grimmert IV of 4th Ward, entered the cellars without authorization, and there, after suffering a painful wound to his right arm, collapsed. Another nurse, P. Mandarin, investigated Golan's absence, and after some time discovered Grimmert on the floor in severe shock. Treatment was prompt and effective, but upon regaining consciousness in the morning, Grimmert began raving to me about being attacked by a dead man. For the moment, I have placed him in the room 13 and notified his landlady of his indisposition. Alas, what Gomuk was another man, one unknown to his institution, and in tragic physical condition. Many grave questions must be answered. Entry 2. I began to question Gomuk about the stranger. Is he a patient? What is his name? How long had Gomuk kept him down there? Had Gomuk kept the stranger there for a long time? Long enough that the mortar sealing the room had cured in such a condition? Had he been giving him nourishment? How had he survived? I am moving the stranger to my private wing, for the moment treating the man with inconsequential direct until more evidence is found. Entry number 3. Even in a French bed, the stranger's appearance is horrifying. Given small amounts of broth, he merely regulates it. He takes in no nourishment, yet lives in a catatonic state. Would electroshock revive him? Entry. After several applications, the stranger awoke, but so weakened that he could not move. He whined and begged indifferent, in a very old form of Greek and Latin, tales of cities crumbling and other darker things. What a mystery, man. It's almost easier to think that we have subtapped some form of group mind or racial memory. And then it ends.
Sounds like fascinating reading. And toss the book over to Dr. Price. I'm sure that you'll get more out of this than I will.
I probably will. Thank you.
And we'll go and find the rest of our group.
Yes, let's find out what's going on over here.
Alright. So, you guys are leaving the asylum. Let's go back to our guys in the villa who are looking for the house, yes?
Yes.
Yes. Let us.
So now, basically you'll be traveling posse, and you'll be staying kind of around in town until you find a manor, because it's going to take you probably a day or two to figure out where everything is.
Okay.
Is that okay? Alright. Yeah. So basically, the town of posse, it's a very small town, and it's very famous because it was the kind of where the King Louis was born, and as such, and basically it's a very small town, but it's very well maintained. So you walk in. So we are basically in a town, and you kind of have a general idea of where the building is, but you may have to look around a bit.
Okay, how about public records? Would it be like a town hall or a...
Yes.
Yeah, that's a good idea.
Yes, a town hall would be, yes. Yes, the town hall is available.
So we should go to the town hall and do some research, see exactly...
Look up the count.
Everything.
Yes. Give me some library rules.
I got a 57 out of 60.
Okay.
I got a 64.
All right. So basically, you find the 18th century documents that pin down the Count's villa on the outskirts of town.
Okay.
And you kind of find actually find the plan layouts of the house as well, kind of the old structure of how it was settled and made.
Cool.
Anything interesting in that, like a sub basement or?
Not that aware of. It only seems to be kind of like the base structure, like kind of like the kind of just like the maybe the two top levels, but nothing below.
Okay. Should we travel to where that location was?
Yes. So basically, you guys go through town. You actually pass by the Church of Colette Notre Dame de Passy. It is the church where St. Louis was kind of attended and possibly baptized, as popular belief. And going past it, you find the location, and you find that the villa isn't there anymore. On top of the villa appears to be a smaller kind of mansion that looks completely different than the villa that you have on the plans. And yeah. there's a sign that says, Doctor et Madame Christiane Lorin, 6, enclosed de l'Abbé Passé, on the outside wall.
Shall we introduce ourselves?
I'm not sure that he would even know anything about the previous building that was on that particular spot. Yeah. We can try. Well, all right, we'll knock on the door.
All right. So you knock on the door. you hear a man calling on French. A moment, please. And basically, he opens the door. And it's a nice, it's a very young-looking man wearing a white kind of coat, like a doctor's coat, with some thin spectacles and a nice mustache.
Okay. I say, hello, we are doing some, oh great, you suddenly have a mustache.
Yes.
Forgive our intrusion. We are doing. Now I can't think of my Russian accent. We're doing some research on 17th century buildings, and we were wondering if you knew anything about the previous buildings that were here.
Yes. But I'm sorry. Who are you?
My name is Alexei Pleasurekov. These are my friends. We have traveled from the United States.
I'm so excited.
he basically goes, yes. Please, come in. Let me get you some coffee and we can discuss this properly, yes?
Oh. Thank you.
Hello, mustache, Patrick.
Thank you. It adds to the thing I'm going for. Basically, as you guys walk in, you notice kind of like a little girl, give or take 8 to 10 years old, kind of that walks by her, that appears to be the daughter of the doctor, and she goes and kind of hides behind her father's leg, and she goes, "Papa, who are these?" And it's like, "Oh, these are guests." Kind of learning. And basically, he sits you down. He's like, "Allow me to make you some coffee, yes?"
Cool. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Could you guys give me a spot hidden?
Sure. No, I managed to get something in my eye, and I may have lost it.
Nope. I failed.
I got a 17 out of 25.
All right. Okay. So he brings out.
Fascinated by the lithographs.
So he basically brings out a tray of coffee and sets it down, and offers the coffee.
Now, the coffee splashed in my eye. That's what happened.
Ah! Now 1 sec. I have to do some rolls here. 1 moment. Oh dear. Oh dear. This is very bad. This is very bad. I need a volunteer from. I need a volunteer from one of you guys.
You know what? I will.
So,
I'm sorry, what
are we volunteering for before you just volunteer?
Can't tell you that.
Dr. Price volunteered.
What's the worst thing can happen?
Dr. Price.
Yeah, I know.
This will not be easy things you've chosen to do. I know that you very bravely and possibly foolishly chose it upon yourself, but let it be known that your sacrifice will not be in vain. The little girl goes to sit on your lap and demands that you entertain her.
Dr. Price is here. Dr. Price is...
No, Dr. Price is not Dr. in that Price group. You have Dennis, you have Dennis, Otis, Alexi, and Rose.
And also Nathan.
Damn it! Stop confusing the group matchups. Jesus Christ. Okay.
You wanted somebody to entertain the child, I'll do that.
Yeah, okay.
Otis, go.
Oh, Dennis will entertain the child.
Yes.
That will go swimmingly.
Yeah.
Yes.
No, I don't mind. I'll do it.
Yes, okay. So, yes, the daunting task. That will probably cost you a D100 of sanity. No, it's all.
Nah, Otis has got younger siblings. She wouldn't bother him.
So basically, you are able to talk to him. So yes, how may I help you, friends?
Well, we were asking if you knew anything about the history of this particular piece of land, the house that was here before, the Comte Fenelik, anything that you might be able to contribute to us.
Oh, yes, I do believe. I've heard the name when I purchased this house. Me and my wife moved here with my daughter, Coyne. She and I are aware well that this house used to be a manor of sorts, a very old manor. Unfortunately, it was destroyed, and as such, we have built upon it, and our lovely home here, as you see.
This is a very lovely home.
Are there any parts of the old house still standing?
Yes, the wall, kind of around it, and maybe a few kind of tidbits of ruins and some kind of the gardens, like the old kind of foundation of where the gardens were, but mostly everything, like the main structure of the building, is gone.
Have you found any artifacts from the old house since you've been here? Old hardware, doorknobs, perhaps?
Any of old clothes or silks? I love silks.
No, I'm afraid not. Funny you should mention it. I've had a few people ask if I've discovered similar artifacts, statues, and the like, but sadly, I have not found anything.
What a pity.
Other people, you say?
Yes, recently. Yes, another person. He actually sent me a letter. Let me go get it. And he kind of stands up and exits and comes back with a letter. This is the letter that was sent to me.
Is it from our buddy?
Hold on. So,
but if he handed it to me, I handed it to one of them because I can't read.
Yeah. All right. So it says to whom it may concern. I realize that I am a complete stranger, and this letter may have nothing well to do to you. My name is Edgar Wellington. I am researching the history of a statue known most commonly as the Sedificar Silmarillion. I have recently come into possession of an old scroll which presents an intriguing description of the item. This piqued my interest, and I am now endeavoring to trace the Silmarillion. My research has led me to your estate address, the name probably meaningless to you, but I have learned through my research. I have learned that the last recorded resting place of the art was found in your house that occupied your land in the late 18th century. The statue was a unique Arabian artifact lost during the events of 1789. The last owner was a German nobleman who lived where you live today. Please, I ask you if you've heard any local stories regarding this information or maybe found any traces of the old house and its possessions on your land, which might have given me clues and the eventual fate of the object. Would you be so kind as to write me a summary of the information? I apologize for the rather strange nature of my request, but I feel I should pursue whatever leads remaining to me. I hope that you will not let go of any legs regarding this. Yours most sincerely, Edgar Wellington.
Edgar Wellington. Is there a postmark where that came from?
It's from the address is from 50 Rue Saint Illerton, Lausanne, Switzerland.
Ah. Well, let's write that down.
Oh, the Swiss.
Can't trust him.
Okay, and okay. So basically, as you guys are talking, so basically, as he hands you the copy, Roscoe, his little daughter kind of bumps your elbow, and the copy spills on your lap and on your arm, and it's a scalding hot coffee. And she screams and yells out in pain, and her father goes to deal with it. But you notice one thing. When he takes a look at her left arm, her left arm, looks to be like completely scarred and inflamed and kind of like almost burnt.
Yeah, if it spills in his lap, he's a little preoccupied, but he will bring that up once he stops hurting.
But this isn't something out of burn. This is like beforehand.
So it was already
there. Saying like she spilled the hot coffee in his lap, though. He would have to deal with that immediately. So like I said, after he stops hurting, he would ask about that. It's like that.
Yeah, that wasn't
coffee. Is she okay?
She's fine. She's fine. Just the coffee, I'm afraid. And basically, he's like trying to cover, and it's like, please give me a moment. And basically, he kind of takes her into her room and just, you know, tries to suit her. And I think we'll end there.
So we look around the room while he is out.
That will probably be next time because I'm just gonna end it there for today.
Okay. We're paused.
Yeah.
You got something to work with next time.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that was episode 2. I hope I've entertained and done a good job of keeping up.
How hot was that coffee? Does Roscoe have a chance of children should survive?
Yes. You will have children survive.
Thank you, Patrick.
No problem.
Yeah, you're doing awesome, man. Great mustache, too.
Thank you.
Mustache was killing me. It's so hard to not laugh at that.
I just kept
following it around the screen. It's great.
Yes.
Well, thanks to everybody that's watching us live. Thanks for watching. Thanks to you guys for playing. And we'll see you guys next Wednesday night.
See you next Wednesday.
All right. Yeah. Have a good rest of the week, guys.